Hey, welcome back to the Blazor Puzzle. This is episode 68. I'm Carl Franklin from AppVNext, and that's my friend Jeff Fritz from Microsoft. Hey, Jeff.
I'll do, Carl. It's so good to be back. Gosh, I feel like we do these every week or something like that.
It almost feels like we do them every week, doesn't it? Oh, wait a minute. We do them every week. Puzzle, Jeff. Jeff really put it together, but it came from somebody who sent us a message on Blue Sky, and they could not for the life of them figure out how to get the remote user's IP address in a Blazor server web app when it's published. So they did finally figure it out for them, but we, you know, that posed a challenge to Jeff, and he said, you know what, there's more to this story. So there, Jeff, take it away. Tell us what you got here.
So you can find all the source code for this, as always. Check it out in the Blazor Puzzle GitHub. This is in the Puzzle 68 repository. So we want to make sure you get the source code so you can take a look at what we're doing here and try this out in your scenario. Because like Carl said, there's more going on here. So this is a Blazor Global Server Interactive application, right? Nothing fancy here. It's all running on the server, because this is where it gets a little funny. Mm-hmm. And I updated the default template, just the default template with the hello world on the front page. But instead of it saying welcome to your new app, I added your IP address in here.
Yeah.
Now, how do we get the IP address? Well, there's a default method that's available on the HTTP context accessor that you can see down here. IP address equals HTTP context accessor. HTTP context connection, remote IP address, map to IPv4, and output that. Now, you need to inject the HTTP context accessor, and you can see that up here at the top. I'm injecting one of those. I also set this so we don't pre-render it at all. You have to make that HTTP context available by, in your Program.cs, adding HTTP context accessor up at the top here.
All right.
So it's available.
Cool.
Real easy to do. And that IP address that's being output here, it has access to both the IPv6 address and the IPv4. So to make it look like something that we recognize a little bit easier, I mapped it to IPv4 using the method internal there. So I'm outputting the HTTP headers here as well so that we can see them and poke around, because things get a little bit different as we go along.
Okay.
Here's what it looks like when I'm running locally on this machine on the metal. Hello 0001 to your new app.
You are the first IP address on the internet. Congratulations.
It feels so good to be the first. Thank you. I'd like to thank the Academy. It's amazing.
Of course, that's not a routable address. That's just a bogus address that means your local metal, right?
Yep. Yep.
It's not even 127.0.0.1.
Exactly. Yeah. There's just a bunch of, you know, typical header stuff here. Nothing interesting to see yet. But this does get interesting when we recompile and run the application as a container running locally. So since .NET 6, we've had the ability to build and run our applications as containers using configuration from within the .NET SDK. It's just another build publish target. You include a NuGet package and configure MS build, and you can build and deploy containers directly from your project.
Well, here you go. This is a little closer, 172.17.0.1, but that doesn't look like a routable address either.
No, it's not. So this is running inside of Docker Desktop on my machine. And Docker Desktop, it sets up a little internal network so that the containers can see each other, and so the host machine is also visible on there to be able to connect in and work with those containers in the little internal Docker network.
So it's like its own little NAT, network address translator.
Yep, you got it. So that's my faux address here, but it's not really, right, what I'm looking for. And I'm already seeing now two different types of addresses. And it's going to get weirder here in a minute when we go and deploy to someplace like Azure. Okay, so now I'm running on Azure.
Okay.
I deployed to an Azure container app.
And yet another address.
And another
that's one. That's not routable.
No. This one is 100.100.0.50. Here's the thing. That's not my address. That's not my machine. That's someplace out on Azure. Because when you're running with container apps or you're running with app service or there's a number of other things, right? You've got that slider that you can use to choose the number of instances of your application that are running. Well,
there's
some sort of a load balancer or a proxy in front of there that knows how to return messages to your individual web servers. That's the address for that proxy.
So in all three of these cases where we get these different non-routable IP addresses, they're coming from some middleman, some network address translation or some proxy, something that's between your app and the internet. So
yeah,
the question is, how do you get the real address? And to answer that, you're going to have to wait because we're going to take a break. We're going to let you think about that for a few seconds. Or you could pause and come back tomorrow or after you've had a chance to investigate. And stick around for the answer. We'll be right back.
I'm going to fill my cup.
Okay. All right, Jeff. So what's the answer? How do we get the actual IP address?
So here's the deal. When those various pieces of network hardware are in place, right? If it's a proxy, if it's a load balancer, if it's something like Azure Front Door, what they'll do is they'll add an extra header on called X_4, and they'll attach the real IP address that connected in to that header. So if I scroll down here, you'll see all the other header stuff, and there's some other goo that Azure adds in here. But here, X_4, and there's my IP address.
Okay. All right, so you're also going to have this issue if you're just publishing an Azure App Service without a container?
You will also have it there because you can still add multiple instances of App Service. You can still have multiple copies of your application running on multiple hosts that are being routed to, so you can scale out your application. But it's going to be a pain in the neck to work with this header, isn't it, Carl?
Yeah, it sure is.
How am I going to know whether to work with the IP address or this header?
Mm-hmm.
ASP.NET has a solution for you. So I'm back here in Program.cs. What we can do is we can turn on the forwarded headers options.
Hmm.
And what this will do is it will take all of those X_4 headers and turn those into the real headers that they're forwarding in on behalf of.
Yeah, the IP address that you're pulling out from the context accessor.
You got it.
Yeah.
Now, there's a little security bit here on lines 30 and 32 so that you can limit those headers that are being configured to only coming in from known networks or from known proxies.
Mm.
This is so that you don't have somebody midway between your request coming in from the browser and your server, somebody going in there and intercepting and injecting some extra headers.
So scroll up a little bit.
Yeah, yeah.
You also have this line, Builder Services Add Data Protection. Is that necessary and what does that do?
Sure. So it is necessary when you're on a system where you're going to have multiple copies of your service running. So when I'm running with Azure Container Apps, I'm running with Azure App Service, and I've got that slider bar that lets me choose how many instances.
Right.
You're going to want this because what this does is it takes that key, that private key that ASP.NET uses to encrypt your cookies, to generate hashes for anti-forgery tokens. That key is going to be stored in a location where it can be shared between the various servers.
Mm.
This way, when you do scale out, they're all using the same key. Now, I don't have to pass any arguments into this when I'm running on Azure, because there's a service that's running on Azure that will properly share that between the ASP.NET services. However, if you're running on-prem or you're running in another cloud or another hosting service, you can provide directions here for how data protection is configured so that it's stored in a database, on a file server somewhere, behind an API. Maybe it's stored in a key vault somewhere. You can provide that extra bit of logic.
Now, there was another thing that the person who engaged us on Blue Sky said, that they had just a regular old Azure App Service with a Blazor Server global server app like you've got here, and they could only get the IP address if WebSockets was turned on. Now, you should turn WebSockets on every time that you create an app service that is going to host a Blazor Server application, because that is the most efficient way that SignalR works. And otherwise, it's going to drop down to long polling, and that apparently doesn't provide the kind of data that you need to get the IP address. That was an observation from that person. What was going on there?
So it's the same thing. You got to make sure that the keys and that the forwarded four headers are being properly passed through so that it does see things. Because we're running with Global Server Interactive, it's using SignalR to communicate back and forth. If it doesn't see matching endpoints, it's not going to properly send and share all of that information.
Right. So it's just a good idea in general to always turn WebSockets on in your app service if you're going to be hosting a Blazor web app with server interactivity.
Yep.
Jeff, this is fantastic news. I mean, you basically covered all the scenarios in which you'd want to get the IP address. And can we check it out and try it?
Oh, I need to redeploy.
All right. So you're republishing here. Right?
Yep. So I uncommented out those forwarded headers messages. It's going to repackage the application as a container, publish it out to my Azure image registry, and reload the Azure container app. And in just a few seconds here, we should see it updated and showing not that 100 IP address, but my address.
And there you go. So that is your ISPs or whatever, your public IP address.
Yep. Yep. So the other thing to note about this, so ASP.NET made my HTTP context remote IP address my IP address that was forwarded. But if we look at the headers, the other thing that it does when I scroll all the way down here is it also creates this entry X_original_4. And it still gives me the original IP address for that network appliance between the server and my browser.
Excellent. Wow, that's great, Jeff. Thanks for going through all this. That's good stuff.
Yeah, it's important to know where things are coming from on your network.
Yeah. All right, and with that, I guess we will see you next week on the Blazor Puzzle. Bye-bye.
Take care, friends.
Thanks for watching. Make sure to check out blazortrain.com and the .NET Show.com for more great content.